This is Monk Rowe, and we're filming at Hamilton College for the Jazz Archive. I'm very pleased to have John Abercrombie with me today.
Nice to be here.
Welcome to the college.
Thanks.
Looking forward to your performance tonight.
Me too. Yeah, it should be really nice. It's just it's a trio tonight, and which is how this band really started. We started as a guitar, organ, and drums, and we've added different instruments along the way. But for this particular performance, mm-hmm. we're back to our sort of beginnings, kind of, which is nice.
Almost 8 years you guys have been?
Yeah, it's about that. Could be even a little longer. I'm not sure, again, time passes so quickly. I'm not sure when the first thing was recorded, but there was the first album or CD was a thing called While We're Young on ECM, and that was recorded after we had been playing some gigs together, and we were starting. And then there was a second one called Speak of the Devil, a live record, which I just listened to in the car coming up today. I sort of wanted to remind myself what we sounded like as a trio. And that's called Tactics, which was recorded live in New York. And then there was an album called Open Land that came out about 2 years ago. And they had Joe Lovano and Mark Feldman on violin and Kenny Wheeler. So it was more like a project.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you listened to that today because you anticipated one of my questions.
Oh, okay.
That was, if you listen to a tape of tonight's performance, Whatever Happens, and then you listen to what you guys were doing 7 or 8 years ago, how does it change?
I think what changes for me is just that, I mean, as usually we're off all doing different things, and then we come back together, and I find that just either with this band or with other bands, I think hopefully you get better. I'm able to, my phrasing is a little different. I have a little more control over what I do than I did when that album was recorded. And then if I listen to that album and go back to listen to something earlier, I realize, oh, boy, I had much more control when we recorded the live album. So I think what happens is you get the ability to, at least I do, to shape things as they're happening a little more. You get a little more mature. Maybe you're not quite as wild and crazy, you know. Mm-hmm. But there's still that element in there, too.
I mean, yeah. That term wild has, I've been reading some of your past interviews.
Oh, really? Does it crop up a lot? Or
it does. Huh. You talked about some of your playing, especially in the fusion world, and that you felt you were kind of wild, and you actually said that your timing suffered for it. Do you still feel that way?
I still feel it. I think a certain kind of timing suffered by playing that music. I think I gained something from it, too, because most of that music, it was very much harmonically, it had no motion. I mean, it was mostly your solos were over one chord, and maybe mm-hmm. two if you really got lucky. And all the rhythms were very sort of straight ahead, almost rock rhythms. You know, they were what we would refer to as even eighth note rhythms, or more Latin style as opposed to jazz swing. So I think what suffered was my ability to play the jazz feeling, the jazz time, swing feel, because I just hadn't been doing it. I was mm-hmm. playing this sort of even eighth note rock and roll, and then also somewhere in between Mahavishnu Indian thing, which is all very even oriented. So the beats were always da 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 da, kind of evenly divided, mm-hmm. and the jazz, of course, is much looser.
Yeah.
So I think what happened when I came back to try and play jazz is that's when I found my time is really kind of odd. You know, I play kind of speedy and nervous for jazz. You know,
mm-hmm.
so I had to kind of rethink things and re-examine how I wanted to play.
Okay. I want to take you back a little bit. You had some experience at Berklee.
Yeah, sure.
Would you be able to put a percentage of what you play now and attribute any of it to your, quote, formal education?
Yeah, I think so. I don't know if I would attribute it as much to the actual education that I got from specific teachers. I think it was more just the experience of being in school, playing, and developing and being around teachers and other students. And if anything, I would attribute certain things, of course, because a couple of teachers that were very important to me. Herb Pomeroy was one. He was a wonderful trumpet player, but his main job at Berklee was to teach. He taught arranging. He taught advanced arranging, which was sort of not really always in the style of Duke Ellington, but that was his guy, you know, so he had love Duke, and he kind of like wrote in that style and more modern, if you can do that, because Duke stuff was pretty modern.
Mm-hmm.
And he also led the jazz workshops, which were small ensembles of anywhere from like four to maybe six people. It could be a couple of horns with a rhythm section. I was in one that was just guitar and saxophone, piano, bass, and drums. And it was wonderful because I had to function like a horn player.
Yeah.
I couldn't read worth. I was terrible. I mean, most guitar players will acknowledge that they it's a difficult instrument to read on. So I remember when they would first write tunes on the board, the saxophone player could read quite well. And I could read read notes. I knew what the pitches were, but I was terrible at reading rhythms. I just didn't know how to do it. So I'd find the notes on the guitar, and I would listen to the saxophone player like mad, just to find out and I'd kind of listen, and I'd get it a few times through. So.
Yeah.
But I think I would have to attribute like a lot of things to Herb and his not just specific things, but just his inspiration, his confidence building. He was a great, he knew how to say things to you like that was very good, or like avoid this. Constructive criticisms. Yeah. I think mostly I'd have to say Herb, and then my guitar instructor, who's a wonderful guy who still lives in Florida, named Jack Peterson. And he was, every week he would change his mind about what you should be learning, because he was a new teacher. The first year I went to Berklee was his first year teaching. And he was from Texas, so I'd come in and he'd say, remember what I showed you, Johnny, that last week? And I said, yeah, Jack. He said, well, forget about that. Now I want you to hear some Bach violin concertos. I want you to go home and learn this. I said, relearn this? So, and then next week, forget Bach, and then it was back to Charlie Christian. So he was always changing, and he was just a good player that he was very inspiring. Mm. So I think I remember those two teachers the most, and then it was just the atmosphere of the school, playing all the time. And then one day you kind of just, you play something and you feel a little more connected than you did. You just sort of hear it a little better. Mm-hmm. And you say, oh, maybe I can play music.
Yeah.
In the beginning, it's all like, a lot of self-doubt, more than anything. And I think it's like, gee, do I sound good? Can I play? What is this anyway? And then one day you sort of cross into another area where your ears begin to open up and you get some confidence. And I think that came from being in school and playing with a lot of these people.
What kind of music was in your household when you were growing up as a kid?
I remember on the television distinctly, I remember two things. I remember Lawrence Welk was on the television. Mm-hmm. And then there was a lot of country music on television. I remember at the time there was these sort of country shows, and there was like a young girl, I think they were brother and sister, they played like guitars and mandolins, and they just played double neck things, like double mandolin on one and then six string on the other. And they would like 3 feet high. I mean, these were kids, and they were playing faster than the speed of light. They're playing all these country rags. But this wasn't music that my parents listened to. We didn't really have music in the house in terms of there was no, there was a Victrola, I guess, not a wind-up kind. We actually plugged it in and it went around, so you didn't have to crank it up. I'm not quite that old, but so they bought me a record player. I think that the music came from outside the house, because the only music in the house really was Lawrence and this country stuff. And I knew pretty early on that Lawrence wasn't for me. I know something just didn't click.
Uh-huh.
I didn't get it, I later learned to like champagne a little bit, from the champagne ladies, but I didn't really like, and all the bubbles, but I did.
Right. What about the rock and roll of the day, the Ventures and all that kind of thing?
That was influential for sure, yeah. I mean, I think because I had chosen the guitar as an instrument, and I didn't choose it because of Charlie Christian or Barney Kessel or Wes Montgomery. I chose it because of people like you're mentioning, like Chuck Berry, the Ventures, Bo Diddley, Elvis Presley, and all these kind of people. So I chose it as a way to like maybe gain social acceptance, And plus I liked the sound of the electric guitar. And my first guitar was acoustic. It was a Harmony guitar I think it was $40, and you could barely put the strings onto the fretboard. I used it once as a baseball bat, I remember. I took it outside and said, somebody throw me one, and I cracked the guitar. I always remember that.
This is a true story.
It's a true story. I liked baseball too. Maybe I just got confused at one point, as well as, do I want to play baseball or guitar? Well, let's use the guitar as a baseball bat. Then we can sort of do two things. But once I got an electric guitar, I think that I was kind of like bitten by the sound. There was something about this sound coming from the speaker, and more than an acoustic instrument. It was just something really exciting and very electric about it. It was an electric guitar, It was very cool, and I loved Chuck Berry. And there was actually a singing duo at the time that I remember very distinctly called Mickey and Sylvia.
Yeah, Love Is Strange.
Love Is Strange.
Yeah.
Love Is Strange was a song that was very popular when I was growing up, and you could hear it on the jukebox, which is where I heard a lot of the music. You'd drop the nickel into the slot, and press the button, and there it would come. And one of these things was Love is Strange, and they had these really hip-sounding electric guitars with maybe tremolo or some kind of weird little effect on them, you know, at the time. And it just, and then I saw pictures of them, and they were playing like sort of solid body Les Paul guitars, and I saw, this is so cool. I mean, I have to know what this is about. So yeah, that music was very important to me. I still like it, but that took me just quickly into hearing electric guitar. And I remember we were talking earlier, I heard Tony Mottola play on the Perry Como show, and he was playing a Gibson electric guitar, and he would sit on a little stool and play pretty chords. And so I got a guitar teacher, and I asked my guitar teacher, I said, can you show me what these pretty chords are that Tony Mottola plays? And he could. He was a good guitar teacher. So that kind of got me into wanting to play something else. And then I think the first jazz guitar I really heard was Barney Kessel. And that sold me on the idea that I wanted to play jazz on the guitar and not rock and roll.
And what age was that kind of
early,
decision?
Early, beginning of high school years, probably like 13, 14, and you know, early teenager.
Yeah.
And I had some friends in my town who were two brothers who played music, and they would take me into their little room where they had their stash of records, you know, and they'd play me Dave Brubeck, Miles, Barney Kessel, Horace Silver, whatever. Mm-hmm. And they were really hip and way ahead of the time. Of course, then I went to my mother and told her I wanted to be a jazz musician. You have to realize I'm first generation. My parents come from England and Scotland. So, I mean, it would have been difficult for an American parents to understand jazz or even know what it meant. But for them, it was like, jazz? Jazz? What's jazz? You know, nobody knows what jazz is. And even in my high school, most people didn't know what jazz was. And I remember the music teacher trying to discourage me from wanting to go to music school to study jazz. She said, you don't really want to do that, John. You do something serious. I said, well, I really like the way this sounds. You know, I don't. So there was in the 50s, you couldn't get a lot of encouragement if you were a young white kid in the suburbs because the music wasn't there. Nobody listened to it, you know. And so you kind of had to like say, well, this is what I really want. And then I found Berklee, which was really, you know, probably one of the greatest things, because Berklee was one of the only places that taught jazz and was serious about it. There weren't very, very few places that would even accept a guitar. Even if you played classical guitar, you couldn't get in. There was no program for it.
Yeah.
And of course, here I was with my little Gretsch electric guitar and my amplifier, and I wanted to play music. And I opened up the Berklee catalog, and there was a picture of Gabor Szabo from Hungary standing there with a Gretsch guitar. I said, I think I relate. I can go here. You know, this guy plays electric guitar, and he studied in this school. And I went there, and I think there were like 10 guitar players the first year. Now there's about over 1,000.
Wow.
Unbelievable. It's just how much it's grown. So, but that's kind of how I got into playing guitar. So the 50s rock and roll was very important to me, and then that kind of naturally seemed to move into Barney Kessel, who was, like I say, was the first one. I still love the way he plays, but. He was the first one I really heard that excited me and made me want to play the guitar.
Did you go on the garage band route at all?
Yeah, I had bands. We had bands like that, sure. I was in a couple of bands like that. The first band I was in, I think, was the very first band I played in had accordion, guitar, drums, maracas, and harmonica, and trumpet. It was interesting. I mean, probably would be a hip band today. You know, you could probably get on a lot of European festivals playing, you know, with this kind of, you know, oddball band. You could call it world music now or something, you know, mariachi, some polka, I don't know, electric guitar. I don't know, you could make a concept out of it. But basically we played VFW Falls and polka gigs, and the accordion player's father was Polish and got us all these, you know, Polish American clubs, you know. And then I was in a second band that played, it had three guitars. Now no bass guitar. This was three guitars, three electric guitars. And the way it was broken up, it was like the Ventures. It was one of those bands where one guy would play sort of the lead part, the higher part. The other guy would strum chords. And then there was a third part. It was the in-between part. It was sort of like you'd play honky-tonk, like ding, 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 sort of like muted guitar kind of. I can't really say. You play in fifths. So there was actually these three parts. It was really orchestrated, you know, and that's the way the guitar bands played. And that was really a garage band. And we would just sit down and work it out all by ear. None of us could read. Just took things from records. One guy would do this, one guy would do that. And I was just starting to learn how to play pretty chords, you know, from my other teachers. So I would bring in some of that, you know. And then we got a saxophone player who could play a couple of standards. So then we would start adding things like Tenderly or Misty or something to the Harlem Nocturne, these kind of tunes. Yeah. So we were starting, you could see it starting to there was a move towards jazz, but there was still this garage band, you know, guitar.
Well, that stuff expanding your harmonic knowledge for sure to get into Harlem Nocturne and those kinds of things.
Yeah, immediately. I mean, just there was something about it was so enticing. You know, these kind of all of a sudden hearing some of these minor, major seventh chords and this harmony, which is doesn't exist in rock and roll. Yeah.
I always find it interesting when the communication element, because I remember playing with my first rock and roll guitarist, and I've been playing for a long time, and he played an interesting chord, and I said, "What's that?" Yeah. And he say, "This." You know, he'd hold up his hand, on it, and I go, "Well, that doesn't mean anything to me." To do guitar players, like, with that trio of guitar players, is that how you would
Sometimes we would do that. I didn't really know the names of everything I was playing, you know. Yeah, I would just kind of, like, give him one of these, you know. And then the other guys would go, "Wow, look at that. I mean, he can stretch more than one fret. You know, how can he do that, you know?" And then later I started to learn what the names of them were, so somebody would say, I say, "What's that?" I say, "That's a G13th, man, you know." And then when I went to Berklee, then I said, "It's a G7th with an added 13th, you know." Then I got even hipper, you know. But in the beginning, you don't know what it is, because I learned it all by rote. You know, my teacher would show me a chord melody. It is where you play the chords and the melody kind of together. And the first thing I learned, I think, was Misty or Tenderly. It was one of the two. I forget.
It was Misty.
It was.
I read
that. Okay, then it was Misty. You're right. So you learn, like, la, chord, note, chord, with the melody on top, and then da-da, chord, da-da, and you know, it was kind of corny, but it made you, you know, opened up my ears to this kind of harmony, and, but I didn't know what I was playing, I just did it by rote, and then later I learned, you know, that this was the one chord, and this was the four chord, and this was, like, a subdominant minor, that's when I went to school, and then I started to hear it. And then once you hear it, you don't really even have to know what it is anymore, because that's what it is. It's what you hear, you know, deep. So you don't need to know the name of it anymore. And that became really apparent when you listen to guys play like Wes Montgomery, and Wes couldn't tell you what chords he was playing. Because he came to the school once, he was invited to the school. This is really an early kind of like workshop. They asked him, invited him to the school to play for the kids. And he came to Berklee, we all met him. And the instructor at the time, Jack Peterson, had this little guitar ensemble, which was like seven or eight guitars playing arrangements, right? And so we were going to play this arrangement and let Wes solo on it. So Jack gave him the music. He went to put it on Wes's stand, and Wes went, no, I don't. And we sort of all knew, you know, that he didn't read music. So he said, "Just play it for me." So we played the tune once. I mean, played through the arrangement. And then it came time for the solo section, and Wes just soloed. I mean, he heard it. He heard exactly where the chord progression went. And it wasn't that he had moved through a couple of keys, you know, little tempo changes, and he just nailed it because he could hear it, you know. And that was like a real lesson right there. It's like, you know, well, gee, I don't have to know what all these scales and chords are. It doesn't hurt that I do, but here's a guy that just hears it. Probably can't even tell you what key he's in. It's just, it's unbelievable. And you know, Chet Baker apparently was the same way. He was a very natural player, but I just. It's so when you do arrive to a point where you hear it, that's what it is, you know, and you don't really have to codify it so much, unless you're trying to teach it. And today, as a teacher, I mean, I have to be able to, like, you know, keep up with students, you know, and they'll start to run circles around me when they're talking about the theory, you know.
And the modes and
all modes that kind of stuff. Thing, I'll go, okay, slow down. Now, wait a minute. This is a melodic minor. Tell me what that is again. I have to ask the student, and they'll say it's this. Oh, I said, well, yeah, I know that, but I wasn't sure that's what it was called. You know, sometimes you forget the names, which is the ultimate goal, is to forget all that and just, and that's what Herb Pomeroy said to me years ago, which is why I liked him so much. I said, "Well, Herb, why do I have to learn all these chords and scales? Why can't I just play?" He said, with a Boston accent, "John, just learn all this stuff and then forget it, and then you can get on with playing music." You know, and that always made so much sense to me, you know, just learn it and then forget it. You know, don't think about it. It's in there. You don't have to think about it.
You don't have to know what it's called.
No.
It's available to you because through your ears.
Through your ears. And also, you've studied it, and you know what it is. So if you had to recall it, you know, and tell someone, like, what the name of it is, you know, to give it a name, you could do it. But you don't. That's not what's the most important. The most important is what's in your head and how you can do it.
Okay. There got to a point at Berklee where did you feel like, I'm ready to get out and play? Well, let me rephrase that. Did you get out and play, like with Johnny Hammond, before you felt you were ready?
I think I was nervous about it, and I was still in school when I was playing with Johnny Hammond. I mean, I was in, I might have been in my third year. I mean, and I got recommended to Johnny Hammond through I used to play in a rhythm and blues band called the Danny Wright Orchestra, and Danny Wright's band had an interesting rhythm section. It actually had a drummer that became my drummer years later, Peter Donald, who lives in California, a wonderful pianist named Carl Schroeder, who's a mad scientist who teaches out in California at one of the music institutes. But it was like three or four horns in a rhythm section. And I started to play a lot in this band. Also, Mark Levine, the trombone player, who you may be familiar with, plays trombone and piano. And I got a lot of help playing in that band. I learned a lot. And then Danny thought I was really, the leader thought, well, gee, really, you could play with this guy, Johnny Hammond. He's looking for a guitar player. I think I'll recommend you. I said, really? You think I could do this? He said, well, you know a lot of standards, right? And I said, I knew a fair amount, and that was it. He just said, he called up Johnny. Johnny said, well, bring your guitar down to this club, and it was a club in Boston, which is no longer in existence. Mm-hmm. And but it was near a club that still functions. There's a club now called Wally's that a lot of the students go to, and Wally's was there when I was a kid, but this other club was called the Big M, which stood for Morley's on the Avenue. I never met Mr. Morley. I don't think I ever wanted to meet Mr. Morley, you know. It wasn't important, but that's where we played 7 nights a week and a matinee on Sunday. And you'd play like 3 or 4 sets a night. You know, you'd play till like 2 in the morning, and you'd get up and go to school. And it was at that point where I realized I really wanted to be a player. You know, I was out playing professionally then and playing with people that had nothing to do with the school. A guy that wouldn't know one mode from the other, could care less how much you knew. All they just wanted to know, did you know the song? Could you swing? Could you play the right changes? Could you play 4-4 rhythm like Freddie Green? He said, play 4-4, man. I just want to hear 4-4. Or Charleston, you know, bup, bup. Really simple, but then once he got to know you, you could play almost anything. It was a real great place to learn to become more of a traditional musician, and also it's a thing that doesn't exist anymore. These kind of apprenticeships and places, yeah. Especially for a guitarist, especially now that all the organ players are dying. I mean, Jack McDuff's gone, Groove Holmes is gone, Johnny's gone. And those are the places where young guitar players got a lot of that experience. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't happen anymore. So I was lucky that I got in when I did, and yeah, but it was at that point that I knew mm-hmm. I wanted to play. I still wasn't totally secure in what was going on, but I knew I wanted to play that kind of music. And then everything changed. Then it became the late 60s, and I met Michael and Randy Brecker, and they recommended me for a band called Dreams, which was a fusion band with a singer, you know. Right. So right. I went to New York and started playing.
Yeah. Can you recall what kind of money you were making with... in that 6 nights a week thing?
Well, I do know that after I played with him for like over a year, it was, I think that the deal was $90 a week in town. I remember him telling that once, and then $110 on the road, pay your own hotel.
Let me do the math there.
Yeah. I mean, everything was so much cheaper in those days, and we used to stay at hotels that were pretty much near the clubs. A lot of them were in ghettos, so they were like... they weren't so expensive, and it didn't really cost that much money to be on the road, you know, in those days. But I remember him telling me that $90 a week in town, $110 on the road, pay your own hotel. Mm-hmm. So if I worked with him, and when I moved to New York, that was when I moved to New York. I don't know what he paid me in Boston. It was probably less, because I was just a student. And then I went kind of on the road with him, and we played. I moved to New York, and I used to live in a hotel. In those days, you could get a hotel by the week, and it would be like 20-some bucks a week.
Wow.
With maid service, you know. So I'd live in these hotels, and I'd go, and we'd play a lot of times at Count Basie's Lounge or these clubs in Harlem. It was Count Basie's. It was a club called Wells. There was also Small's Paradise, which I never played at, but there was about 3 or 4 of them. Club Baron, which I did play at. There was a place in New Jersey called the Key Club that I played at. And so you'd start to play all these joints, Then that's when he started paying me a little more money, you know, and I began to become more of a professional musician. And also, I was out of Boston, and I was in New York, you know, and I didn't stay there. I went back to Boston. It took me a couple of times to actually land in New York. Even when I met Mike and Randy, I was still torn between Boston and New York. But I went on the road with this band called Dreams. Now I was in a completely different thing. With Johnny, I wore a suit and tie, and I played If I Were a Bell and blues. You know, and all these kind of tunes. When I started playing with the Dreams band, I wore leather pants and headbands, and I played with wah-wah pedals and played over one chord. I mean, I got a real identity crisis. I didn't know where I was going, you know, because mm-hmm. I had really wanted to be just a jazz player, and then all this explosion happened, and then whatever Miles Davis did, everybody did. If Miles got a wah-wah pedal, everybody played with a wah-wah pedal. Trumpet players, saxophone players, it didn't matter. Of course, guitar players always had the wah-wah pedal.
Were Blood, Sweat, and Tears in Chicago a reason for some of those things?
I think they were a definite reason for Dreams. I think Dreams was a band that was, I mean, it was a, they like, guys like to play that way, but the band was also put together to try to be successful. I mean, they saw the success of Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and Randy Brecker had been in Blood, Sweat, and Tears, mm-hmm. and actually left before the band went gold. I mean, he did an album with them called The Child is Father to the Man, and then he quit. He said, oh, I don't want to do this stuff. And then Lou Soloff took the gig, and Lou was on the famous Spinning Wheel record, and that went wherever it went, and, you know, Randy could have kicked himself, I think, so... Dreams was kind of started to try to be a band like that, but it just wasn't as successful because it was too weird. The horn players were too interesting. The guitar player was completely off the wall, me. The singer was a pretty good singer, but he wasn't powerful like David Clayton Thomas or one of those guys. So the band never really, it didn't quite know what it wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And so that band kind of, I left that band and went back to Boston to play in another band with electric vibes and drums, and it was called The Stark Reality, which I've never spoken about much in interviews, but it was led by a vibes player named Monty Stark, and therefore the name The Stark Reality. Mm-hmm. And Monty had fuzz and everything on his vibes. He was a very creative, interesting guy. Still is, to the best of my knowledge. And so I'm back and played with them for a couple of years. We made one CD, which was the music of Hoagy Carmichael's. It was Hoagy Carmichael's children's music. This is very odd because Hoagy Carmichael's son, Hoagy Jr., worked at a television station in Boston, WGBH. We all became friends because Monty was doing some music for the television thing. So Hoagy kind of hooked us up with his father. His father had this book of kids' tunes. It's the strangest thing in the world. We recorded them for Ahmad Jamal's record label, which I think was called HAP Records, which I think had our record on it, maybe one other record, and then went bankrupt. It was never, you know, my mother's the only person with a copy of this record. Mm-hmm. It was just hysterical things that I was involved, you know, like involved in. And then finally, in the early 70s, I moved to New York to play with Chico Hamilton on a recommendation from a friend who was leaving the band. And that's when I moved to stay. And then I never went back to Boston. And then I started becoming a New York musician.
Yeah. Did your parents become comfortable with your choice of living eventually?
Eventually they did, but it took a long time. I think it really, I don't know if it ever really quite sunk in, you know, because, you know, they'd always say, well, why don't you, you know, can't you go back to, because I didn't quite finish Berklee. I didn't get the degree, the music ed degree. And they said, why can't you go back to Berklee and finish and get that? I said, no, I'm working now, you know. It sort of reminds me of, like, you know, there was some one Woody Allen movie where his parents come on at the very end, you know.
Oh.
I forget which one it is, and they're saying, if you don't know, I mean, he could have been a lawyer, he could have done this, he could have done that. Look what he did with his life, you know. And yet, they're talking about someone who's, like, ridiculously successful, doing exactly what he wants to do. But I think parents will never, they never let go of that somehow, you know. Mm-hmm. But what I always appreciated was they, even though they had no idea what I wanted to do, they let me at least pursue it. Mm-hmm. And when they saw I was making a living, they just said, fine. I think in their own way, they were proud of what I did, but they never really understood the music.
Yeah.
But that's okay. I'm not sure I do sometimes.
Uh-huh. Right? You seem to have had your tastes in a lot of different places. Has it always been of your own choosing?
No, I mean, I think, it gets mixed up. Sometimes it's hard to know whether it's your own choosing. Sometimes you find yourself in a situation that you think you wanted to get in, and then once you're in it, you realize you shouldn't be there.
Mm-hmm.
I'd say, since I started playing this music, most of it's been pretty much stuff I like to do. It hasn't always been my own choosing. Sometimes somebody will hire me and I need the gig, especially when I was younger, and I would take any gig that was offered to me. From the time I started working in Boston as a musician until I moved to New York, where do I go, how much do I make, you know, what do I have to play? And then as I got a little older and I sort of found myself getting a little bit of a reputation, I found that I could do more of what I wanted to do. Not that I could do everything I wanted to do, for sure. I still can't, but more or less, especially once I started recording for ECM and starting to develop more of an identity, you know, and I had my own records. And that happened in the early, that happened pretty quickly in the early 70s, once I, about around 74.
Yeah.
And before that, I had worked with Billy Cobham, which was a great experience. And that was like a return to the Dreams band, because it also had Michael and Randy. And then, then I got a phone call one morning from Jack DeJohnette, and he just asked me if I wanted to come up and play at his house. And I said, sure. So I went up, and we played, and we started a relationship. And that was what started to pull me back away from the pure fusion music and put me back closer to where I had started.
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting how names get passed around and people just call you because
it's all word of mouth. Yeah, it's all word of mouth. He just knew my, he didn't know what I played like, but he knew someone mentioned my name to someone and they mentioned it to Jack, and he was looking to start a band and try to do something, and he wasn't playing with Miles anymore. He was kind of on his own, and matter of fact, at one time we had a band with myself and Mick Goodrick, also a great guitar player, and Ron McClure, and then we had a band with Clint Houston, a bass player, and then finally Jack formed a band with myself and Alex Foster, a saxophone player, and Mike Richmond on bass, and we toured for a while as a band and made a couple of records for Manfred, for, like Manfred, I say Manfred, ECM, Manfred Eicher. And but that's when I met Manfred and ECM, and I met Ralph Towner, and then this whole thing started with ECM.
Yeah.
And I did my first recording in 74. And I knew Jack, so I asked him to be on it. And I had known Jan Hammer, the great Czech musician, because we used to share an apartment in Boston, me, him, and George Mraz. It was like two Czechs and, you know, whatever I was. Maybe I was a bounce Czech. I don't know. But we shared an apartment together, so I knew them just as friends and roommates. And Jan was just such a tremendous musician, and I knew he played organ, and I wanted to do something that reminded me of where I had come from, so that's why I chose him, because he could play such great organ. And we did this record in 74, which sounds nothing like an organ trio record for the most part, but it's there. The sound of the organ is there, and but the music's very different.
Yeah. I love the critics sometimes let their personal feelings show. This one fellow said, from the CD Guide to Jazz, he says, John is cited or blamed for helping create the ECM sound.
Cited or blamed.
Apparently he didn't like the ECM sound.
He didn't like the ECM. Well, it's too bad for him. I mean, also, I don't think it's, I mean, in a way, ECM, you know what, I mean, people talk about that. It's just... I mean, the ECM was a recording label before I went on it. I mean, they were recording Jan Garbarek, they had recorded Keith Jarrett, they had recorded Ralph Towner, Eberhard Weber, there were some European musicians. And so it was starting to develop, it was just the beginning. The first records, I think, were Paul Blais had a record, you know, whatever. And all of a sudden, Manfred decided he'd like to record me. So I think my first record, you know, so that's when I started recording in 74. I think this label actually started probably in maybe the very late 60s, like 69 or 68, 69, or maybe not till 70. And I think after a while, I think a lot of the recordings were done in particular studios, like in Oslo or in Stuttgart. A lot of times they were done with similar musicians playing with each other. There might be I might be playing on a record with Kenny Wheeler, and then there was Jack DeJohnette, and then there'd be a Jack DeJohnette record that I would play on, and then Jack would play with, or Kenny would play with somebody else, and Jan Garbarek would play, and then I did a record with Jan Garbarek, and, you know, it did a record with Enrico Rava, which had a Norwegian rhythm section, and you wind up playing with a lot of players who play with these other people, and you do them in the same studios. The engineer was always, most of the times, it was this wonderful guy, Jan Erik Kongshaug, who's a Norwegian and a great engineer and also a great guitar player. And Manfred Eicher was always the producer. So you take a lot of similar musicians, but the same producer, a lot of times the same studios, one or two of the same engineers, you're going to wind up with something that doesn't sound, there's a consistency to the sound, and if you go back and listen to Blue Note records, they all sound pretty, I mean, Joe Henderson's playing with McCoy, and then McCoy asked Joe Henderson to play on his records. And it's, I mean, maybe it's stylistically what that guy was talking about, is he just doesn't like the way things were recorded. I mean, I always thought ECM records were some of the, especially in the present day, were some of the more better and beautifully recorded recordings, you know?
Yeah.
I think I also love Blue Note records and Columbia records, but you know, I never was too crazy about CTI, which had a sound too. It sort of sounded a little plasticky to me, slick. And I think ECM just had a wonderful way of sort of like making the music sound like it's very, not coming from like, there's the guitar, there's the piano, there's the drums. You know, it made it sound like we were all playing in the same place, mm-hmm. and had some kind of a group sound to it.
Do you think European musicians play significantly different?
Some of them do, sure, for sure. I think, I mean, you take someone like Jan Gabarek, and he can play the saxophone in a lot of different ways, but he's not, you know, you're going to hear a very strong Norwegian, you know, a folk kind of element in his playing, because that's what he wants to pursue. But there are also a lot of European musicians who pride themselves on playing bebop, and they want to be like American jazz musicians. And there you won't hear much difference, really. I mean, you'll hear the guys pretty much sound, it's interesting, they sound the same, you know, like in Stuttgart or Tokyo or, you know, Kongsberg or any place you go. If they study the same mm-hmm. music, if they're all playing out of the real book and they're all playing Stella by Starlight and they all listen to Lee Morgan records, they're all going to wind up sounding the same. And you could say that's a sound, you know. You know, why was he cited or blamed for playing the trumpet that way? You know, everyone imitated him. There he made a sound. Uh-huh. Charlie Parker could be blamed for a lot of, you know, everyone tried to sound like Charlie Parker.
Right.
But then when you find musicians, I think especially more and more now, you find European musicians who go back to their roots, go back to music of their country. Hmm. They try to incorporate the music of Norway or Sweden or wherever they happen to be coming from, I mean, and into jazz. And then you have people that record for ECM that, I mean, there's this wonderful oud player named Anwar Brahim, I think, I'm not sure if you're pronouncing it right, Brahim, but he doesn't play jazz at all, he plays oud. But he improvises, you know, and he did an album with Dave Holland, it's wonderful, you know. But then again, in the end, you start to raise the other question, well, what is jazz? And
yeah.
I mean, a lot of what's on ECM, I wouldn't consider coming from a pure strain of jazz at all, but it's coming from the spirit of it, which has to do with a lot of improvising. And that's one of the aspects of jazz that, you know, that can take it away from being the pure form of jazz, which has to do with blues and African-American music and you know, what the Ken Burns show presented, which is definitely true, and I really believe in that. There's a pure strain of jazz. But then there's something else that's jazz influenced and inspired, and that's improvisation. And I think maybe you don't quite call it jazz in the purest sense, but it's jazz in the spirit of what the music is. And I think there's a lot of disservice when they don't talk about that kind of music, because there's some great improvisers who don't play in the jazz tradition, you know. Mm-hmm. I happen to be kind of caught in the hole. I'm walking funny lines, because I mean, I really consider I'm a jazz guitar player, but I also like to play things that sound nothing like jazz. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't bother me at all, you know. I don't feel like I'm breaking the rules, you know.
How much has the changing technology allowed you or helped you to do some of that, to go in those different directions?
At one time I thought maybe it had a lot to do with it, but I don't think it has too much to do with it. I think I've always enjoyed, even in a low-tech world, to experiment and try to pull things out of the guitar that made it sound like not so much like a mm-hmm. guitar. I think the only period where it became even further removed from that was when things got more synthetic. I was fooling around with a guitar synthesizer, and the guitar was attached to all sorts of keyboards and modules, and then it really started to, I enjoyed it, but it started to get so far away from playing the guitar that and it was also a lot of problems involved and a lot of equipment and just too much stuff. You can't go on the road and can't travel with all this, so I just basically gave it all away and went back to playing the guitar. So I really don't, I think maybe that was one place where technology kind of came in and said, oh, you know, you have a lot more opportunities now. You don't even have to sound like a guitar. You can sound like a flute or a piano. And that was, I went crazy with it. I thought it was just fantastic. But then after a while, I just came back to the guitar because there was more nuance in it somehow. And there's more control. You can do more with the string. You know, you mm-hmm. can bend it and inflect it. But you can't do that with a synthesizer as well.
Yeah.
So I don't think the technology's played that much of a role. I think things sound better now. In the old days, I mean, you didn't have much of a choice. You had like two different kinds of amplifiers to play through. Mm-hmm. Now you've got like a lot of different things you can choose from, and digital reverberations and kind of things that make the music, they makes it sound more like it's been recorded. It makes it sound, so when you hear it live, it has a more pleasant sound than, to my ears, than just something that's coming out of a broken, you know, Fender's amp speaker, you know. And in the old days, that's pretty much all you had. You had like an amp, and you were lucky if it was working, you know.
Right. You had stated way back in 76 that you liked Chinese and Japanese music.
Yeah.
There's so much space in it.
Very much. I love it. I don't listen to it so much now, but I remember there was a one time when I went to Japan, I went to, I don't know if you're familiar with the No theater, you know, where they wear the masks, you know, and I think all the parts are played by men, even if it's a woman, but they've got all these weird masks, and off to the side would be three guys. One was a singer, one played a string, and one played a woodblock or a percussion, you know. And the music was so far out. I mean, it was it made John Cage sound like cocktail music. I mean, it was like, I mean, you've got to realize this stuff is from like, I mean, centuries old, you know. And all you'd hear was this, like, you know, I'm saying, how do they count this? I mean, no one's going one, two, you know. They're not. They don't have a conductor going like this. I mean, how do they feel the space? But it always sounded like they, you know. Maybe it's just a certain maybe. When I go, hey, and then you're going to go, but you have to wait. And they just know when to do it. And it was amazing. And the music, it was beautiful. So I've always liked this music for that reason, too, the space. I always like the sound of it, too, just the way, like, I remember hearing a Chinese violin being played somewhere at a ferry boat stopping somewhere in Seattle. There was some Oriental guy, and he was just sitting on the floor playing like a thing with a bow. And it would just, like, I mean, it would just open your floodgates if you let it. I mean, the sound was just so emotional, and it was just this thing being bowed. I don't know, maybe a couple of strings, you know. You probably would recognize, if you heard it, it sounds like a violin, but more. I don't know what they call it.
I think they call it an ear hoo or something like that.
Yeah, maybe
like
it was that. It was absolutely just devastating. It was an amazing sound. So I always liked that kind of stuff. So I've always been, the fact here, if you're attracted to that, then you try to draw things out of your own instrument. They won't make it sound. You try to kind of. Actually, you try to copy something else. You're influenced by another culture, you know, and that's the thing I like about that music. And it's why I enjoy trying to play with people sometimes that I know I can't play their music, but I might take some element of that and just play with it, you know.
Yeah.
And then it starts to color the other music. And on top of it, I still like to play, you know, swing music and bebop too.
Uh-huh.
So it's a funny combination. Sometimes I don't know quite which way to go. You know.
But you're bound to satisfy yourself one way or the other, right?
Yeah, I try to make myself feel good about what I'm playing. Usually it's the band tonight, I mean, it'd be interesting to see which directions we take, because we'll probably play a little more traditional things than we would normally do with the violin with Feldman, because the band has really been going in a more outer direction, you know, with Mark and it. Playing a lot of very abstract kind of pieces. With the trio, we might come a little more inside. It'll be interesting to see what we do.
I've always been fascinated by the challenge of hearing, I guess what you would call alternate chord changes, you know. If your organist decides to start some new substitutions that you haven't heard before. How do you nail those, or do you?
Well, some of them you just hear. I mean, some of them are you know, might be more things you would expect. I mean, just kind of substitutions that occur a lot. He generally, he won't go too far away from what we play. I mean, he won't play things that I'll never hear unless we're improvising really freely. And then you don't try to nail anything. Then the whole idea is not to really nail anything, but just to sort of kind of play. It's like playing alone together. You can be playing together, but you might have your own separate little story you're telling, you know, and yet you're listening to the other person, and you just kind of try to cross paths at a certain time. If somebody plays certain kinds of substitutions in a song form or a traditional song, it could throw you, and, you know, it depends what they play, you know. I've actually remember doing a record date once that Mark Copeland was playing piano, and Peacock was it was Mark's record, and Peacock was playing bass, and we're playing a blues, and we're recording it, and you know, I mean, I had to stop because they were, I mean, it's not that they were really playing substitutions. They were just chromatically sort of moving, shifting the harmony around in such a way that I couldn't get a center on anything. And I don't know if I stopped the take or maybe I waited till it was finished. And I said, you know, I mean, this is great. I mean, you know, but I have no idea what to play over it. I mean, could you be a little more just traditional for me? Mm-hmm. Or maybe, you know, just, as, you know, I sort of blame myself. And I said, oh yeah, no problem, you know. So there's sometimes you're never going to get it, you know. I mean, sometimes, and I don't worry about it. And if I really can, I might just ask somebody. I might just say, what the heck were you playing? I mean, you know, what was that? You know, because if you play it again, I want to know what it is. You know, because I didn't catch that. You know,
yeah.
If I'm in doubt, I sometimes just won't play. You know, I mean, I'll let something go by.
Mm. Just recently, this is 1986. Mm. You said playing what you hear is the greatest challenge.
I still believe it. I mean, because it's very easy to get. I mean, and I still do. We all do. I mean, it's very easy just to get wrapped up in like finger wiggling or knowing, you know, like, well, I just or just sort of going on automatic pilot. And you have to have a certain amount of that. That's just like technique and vocabulary. But it's nice to be able to really. It's nice when you can start to hear all of these things, and that you when you play that it comes out in a way that's. Not so premeditated and natural, and that you hear it as you're playing. You can sort of hear one phrase moving into another phrase, and there's a logic to it. Yeah, I still think it's the greatest challenge because I don't do it all the time. I mean, I try. You know, when I'm playing at my best, I'm really hearing everything for most of what I play. But you know, it's not always going to be the case.
What's the challenge of dealing with record labels and? Keeping your place in the market these days?
I'm fortunate this way. I mean, I really am, because I don't have to deal with them in the same way that other people do. Some people have to change their labels every couple of years. I mean, because that's, you know, if you don't sell a certain amount of records, I mean, it's sayonara, arrivederci, hasta la vista, goodbye, so long, been nice to know you, forget about it. You know, they just won't hire you again. With ECM, I mean, I can do a record every year and a half. It's not going to change, unless Manfred one day wakes up and says he doesn't want to have a record company anymore and decides to sell it, then my situation could change. So I don't have to really go to a lot of record companies, and I feel very fortunate. I mean, I don't have to keep shopping new stuff or call up and try to find a new label. And when I do record for another label, it's always as a sideman, or maybe it's a cooperative project with somebody. So I don't really worry about that because I'm not tied to that record company. Mm-hmm. So I really don't have a problem. I think it's hard, if you're not with a record company that has any clout, it's hard to get noticed. And you'll notice who the record companies are that really have the big machinery, and the ones with the biggest machinery, the ones with the most toys at the end will win, but the ones with the biggest machinery can make the most noise, buy the most ad space, put their acts on a festival, you know. And I don't like that aspect of it, but because ECM doesn't really have that. It's very well respected, but it doesn't have that kind of clout. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really want to be that kind of a label. They're not into that. And they don't have that kind of money anyway. So it's the bigger American companies are the ones that, you know, the machines.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of good musicians record for them. It's just like if you get in on one of those things, your chances of work and exposure are greater, but if you don't sell, you're gone right away. You know?
Is there any kind of discrimination with the age of musicians these days that are landing on those kind of labels, do you think?
I think there probably is. I think I would almost bet that it, yeah. Like if I wanted to go to another label right now at my age, I might be able to land a deal with somebody. Somebody might give me a shot, because I've got a proven track record. But an older musician trying to, you know, who wasn't as established, probably wouldn't get a deal. No, I think there is a tendency towards the brand new and terrific, you know, or brand new. Who knows whether it's terrific or not? I mean, there's lots of young, brand new talent. I mean, they come. You've probably heard these kind of phrases before. I mean, they seem like guys walk out of universities with their saxophone here, and the press agent here's here, the manager's here. Mm-hmm. The record label's there, and the suits are cut and tailored, and everyone's, you know. It's a manufacturer thing, and it's not that some of these guys can't play, but some of them really don't play that well, or they're marketed very quickly, And it's interesting because, I mean, years ago I remember having conversations with people and saying, you know, gee, why couldn't they, you know, or I remember conversations, gee, why couldn't they sell jazz? Because in those days, I mean, the only reason I knew Coltrane was playing in town was I would walk down Boylston Street in Boston and I'd see it on the marquee, John Coltrane Quartet. Hey, man, Coltrane's in town. Let's go. Bill Evans is here. Wow, cool, let's go. And the place might be packed, but there might be 15 people. There was no big hullabaloo. There was no big, huge band. I mean, nowadays, I mean, it's like, I mean, if you read some of these magazines, you know, like, and these ads for records, it's like the same kind of stuff they do for movies, you know? You know, when you open it, if movie's just coming out and you see the ad for the movie, I laughed, I cried, movie of the year, Boston Globe nominated, I threw up watching it, it was so good, you know? And it's the record business is starting to look like that. You open these magazines and it's all shiny and flashy, and it's become it's a marketable thing now. It's a marketplace. Jazz, they sell it like they sell shoes.
Is that good or bad?
Very good question. Huh? I mean, I think it cheapens the whole thing. Maybe I'm just jealous though because I don't get sold that way, you know, as much. But I think it's I'm just trying to be honest. But I think basically it's kind of a. It's cheapens and it's not that it just cheapens. It sort of like tells people what they're supposed to like. People don't have the ability to make up their own minds as much as I think maybe they did some years ago. It's just all like, you know, it's what's trendy. I mean, it's like, you know, like cell phones are in and a certain kind of jazz is in and everything's just in. And I don't know who runs this stuff, but I sure like to meet them and tell them what I think of them, you know, because it's just, it seems like there's somebody, there's some people somewhere that do this. They sit around and they go, wouldn't it be cool if we could do this and we could do that? And we can make the cell phone speak to the computer, and then the jazz musician can have the cell phone implanted in his horn. And I mean, I just have these weird fantasies that there's people back there, and there's a small group of people, and they do this stuff, and they wield a lot of influence. And I may not be that far wrong. I know I'm getting into dangerous areas, but that's okay, you know. This is for the archive, and this is going out on public television. And if it was, I'd like it to, you know.
Yeah.
I wish I could do it for public, you know, like.
We'll see what we can arrange.
Maybe you can get it out there.
You know, if you had the opportunity to address those 1,000-plus guitar students at Berklee, and maybe this would be a subject you might address, but what would you say to them about how to prepare for the future of where this music's at?
Oh, man, I mean, you could just tell them it's a, don't quit your day job. You could say it's a, no, you could say, I mean, the hardest thing is with a lot of players. What I always tell the ones, I mean, and I can't address 1,000 of them at a time, but even with the students I have, you know, if they play really good, I always tell them, look, I said, you know, I hope you really like this music, you know, because if you don't, I mean, there's a lot of you guys around right now. I mean, there's a lot of good young players. I have a couple of students at the New England Conservatory where I teach now, you know, about 8 times a year. I mean, they can really play. I mean, I've had a few of them that are, you kind of go, wow, this guy can play, really play, you know. And when he gets out in the real world and he's more of he's really going to be able to play. But where are all these guys going to work, you know? And I always try to tell them, I always try to say, look, keep yourself open to all the aspects of music, you know, whether it's being a jazz player, maybe it's writing songs, maybe it's as a producer. Mm-hmm. I mean, there could be a place in music for a lot of people, but there's only so many places that people who are going to be quote unquote performers, or especially jazz performers, are going to be able to play. I mean, there's the amount of venues that haven't changed dramatically since when I was starting to play, and there's like 100 times more players out there. I'm lucky I have a record label and a reputation. To be a young musician coming now, it has to be tough from that point of view, because it's just, there's so many guys, and there's just not enough places to play. So I just tell them, make sure you really love this stuff, because you're going to have to be doing it for that reason if you want to be a jazz player, because there's not going to be, you know, and don't even worry about anything else. Just only do it for that. As long as you can get by, and then if you're really true to what you do, things will come your way, you know, probably you'll make it, you know, you'll make a living and you'll be able to play with your music, and hopefully maybe you'll get very successful, you know.
Yeah. Let me run a few names by you, and maybe they have an impression and maybe they don't. Eddie Lang.
I don't know his playing that well, but I remember, I mean, kind of like the father of a modern kind of guitar. One of the fathers of modern guitar for sure, but I remember his playing to be very, not virtuosic is the right word, but he was more of a, kind of a, almost like a soloist, like a real complete kind of guitarist, could play chord melodies, and kind of like a piano.
Yeah.
He was more like a piano player. And when he played alone, I know there were the duets with Lonnie Johnson, which was really interesting because you could hear these two really very different styles. Eddie sounded very, very calculated in a way, you know, very clean, and of course Lonnie was more of a blues player, you know. So I thought that was it was interesting that they were a team and played together.
How about Django?
The passion, you know, fire, brilliance, you know, absolutely just brilliant. There's no other word for it. I mean, just how anybody could play that way. Again, I mean, it was, even when I went to school, I mean, there was criticism that Django's not really a jazz player. He had so much of the gypsy fire and a certain kind of scalar thing that he would do in a way, just the way he would play. Yeah, it didn't sound like Charlie Christian. Mm-hmm. But I mean, to me it was still jazz, you know, and I think that was one of the early experiences of hearing someone play who wasn't coming from the American jazz tradition, but who was improvising. Just incredible stuff, and playing standard songs that everybody played all around the world. But he had his own way of playing them too. He was unique. I mean, passionate, fiery, brilliant, unique. And he did it all with just two fingers or something. Yeah. You know, it's pretty amazing.
What about Jimi Hendrix?
I considered Hendrix was like a. He was the one rock and roll guitarist that I really listened to. I mean, I didn't really listen to a lot of the other guys. Mm-hmm. I mean, I heard them. I liked some things, but when I heard him, it was like, yeah. I mean, it was like listening to a jazz musician, but playing a different kind of music. Mm-hmm. He was played so fluid and liquid and just soulful, and he was so creative that he could have been playing anything. You know, he could have been any instrument. You know, the vocabulary was not jazz like I know jazz, but it felt really improvised. It felt loose too. It felt like it really had a loose kind of jazz quality. I just think he was the one. I mean, I kind of got, you know, when I heard that, when I heard an album called Axis Bold as Love, that's when I went and bought a fuzz tone and a wah wah pedal, and I said, I really like this stuff. I want to play. I don't know if I want to play like that, but I mean, I want to try to do some of that, you know. Mm-hmm. And that was, I think he had that impact on a lot of jazz musicians. And not all the rock musicians did, you know. I mean, but Hendrix, I think, universally probably had a strong impact, not only on guitar players, but on a lot of people that grew up in my period, horn players. Everybody was like, oh, that's, they would hear it on a record. They know immediately it's Jimi Hendrix. The other guys, I couldn't tell. Uh-huh. Particularly. Later in years, I wound up really liking Eric Clapton, but I didn't really care for Cream all that much. I mean, I thought it was very interesting, but it was kind of like a wall of notes that never really, it had a lot of energy to it and excitement, but I didn't really get the melody to it. You know, it didn't seem very melodic, and that's why I thought Hendrix was very melodic.
Did you ever see him?
No, I never did. I'm surprised I never did, because I saw so many great jazz musicians, and I was in that scene with playing with fusion bands, but I never got to see a lot of the great rock players. Played opposite Chicago once, I remember that, and that was really enjoyable, and I heard some bands, and heard that band Mountain one time with Leslie West. It was so loud, my stomach was rumbling. I had to leave the... It sounded good, but I remember it was in the Village Gate. It was just like the music had me pinned against the wall.
Have you ever had any trouble with playing the fusion type thing and volume and all that?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's. I mean, when I used to play with Cobham, I mean, sometimes you'd come off a gig and your ears would be ringing.
Yeah.
And the roadie would come over and say, "Congratulations, you've gone beyond the threshold of pain for the third concert in a row." You know, I say, "No wonder." I mean, you know. Okay. And now I play. Yeah. Now I just won't play so loud. I mean, it's only so loud I'll play because it just hurts my ears. There's certain frequencies that hurt my ears.
Yeah.
I guess the high frequencies really just go right through them. I remember a concert with Al Di Meola and Jan Hammer that I went to in San Francisco. And I don't even think they were playing probably as loud on the stage as it was pumped out into the PA.
Sure.
And people were sitting there with their fingers in their ears listening to the concert, you know, and there were people, and some of them were just kind of like, yeah, man, grooving. And it was like, I felt like someone had taken daggers and had jabbed them through my eyes, or like, right, it was just like so painful. I mean, I didn't want to have anyone see me. I was kind of like really got down real low and kind of crept out of the theater and just like went away and said, this is, I can't listen to this. And maybe not even at the fault of the musician, you know, he's just, it was just so loud. And that decided I never want to play music that loud, ever. It just has no place for me. I mean, I don't get it, you know. And I have played it that loud.
Yeah. What about Weather Report? Have any thoughts on them?
Well, they were probably, of all the groups, I guess, the most colorful, the most musical, the most interesting. I always, for a short period or a period, especially when I started playing the guitar synthesizer, I wanted to... I kind of always looked to Zawinul as kind of a role model, and since I was playing with Peter Erskine, who had played with Weather Report, you know, he would always give me some insight into how Joe would do something or how he thought about things, and it's interesting. He's a very, very creative man. He's one of the only people I can listen to play the synthesizers, because he just uses them to create all this wonderful color and atmosphere, and and of course him and Wayne Shorter. It was a fabulous band. I mean, I think there were two bands from that period that kind of stick out in my mind, and I always say it would be Weather Report and the Mahavishnu Orchestra, that had completely different approaches to playing that kind of music, and of course Miles's bands. But I thought most of the other stuff that I would hear, including the stuff that I was involved in, not that it was bad. I mean, some of the stuff I played with Billy Cobham's band was tremendous fun, and I think some of it was quite good. But I think a lot of the music out there was just, after a while, I think it was just people just trying to make money, and I mean, it really didn't. But yet, I always felt with Mahavishnu, it just was totally inspired kind of music. And with Weather Report, it was just, these guys were just were so cool about putting things together. They just really had a, they just did it. And when you tried to imitate it, it never worked. I mean, I used to always try to imitate that stuff when I was younger, and it just never quite worked. I don't know.
One more little quote I was curious about here. You weren't talking about yourself, I don't think, but you've noticed a syndrome that some people have where they feel guilty about being a great musician. Do you remember saying that? Or
I don't know about being a... I think that gets into a really... You know, that could open up another whole can of worms. It gets very psychological. I mean, I think when people aren't... I think if you don't feel, you have trouble dealing with the fact that maybe you play well, it could be tied to a whole bunch of issues. And I don't know if it's a syndrome. I don't know if I really, well, I've known a lot of players over the years, you know, the kind of player that, you know, they'll finish something, you know, and it'll sound really good. And I won't name any names, but they're friends of mine. And I go, oh, that really sounded great. And they go, oh, man, I can't get it together. I think maybe I was talking about that players that won't allow themselves to accept anything good about themselves. You know, then there's the reverse, of course, the people that are, you know, constantly, you know, like just kissing everything they do. You know, and I think there's just like a, I think neither thing makes sense. I mean, I think you, if you fall in love with everything you do and you don't have any editing and you don't have any criticism of your own playing, I mean, I think you're in trouble. But I think the reverse is also true. I mean, if you walk around like beating yourself up because, you know, you don't think you can play, and yet, and that actually is the more dangerous of the two in a way, because it stops the process. You know, you're never really happy with what you do. Mm-hmm. Maybe I think I was talking more about that because that's tied to like whole issues about how people feel about maybe themselves and how they're, you know, what their life was like when they were younger. And so then you get into stuff that actually comes up in a therapist's office, which is very interesting, but maybe not
right
for the archives.
I can't help.
When I don't want to go there, because I don't.
For our guitar viewers, what's your instrument of choice these days?
The actual instrument I'm playing?
Yeah.
Well, I brought to the concert tonight, I brought two instruments. It's funny because I was just listening to a couple of recordings coming up, and I for many years I played an Ibanez style Les Paul. Then I switched to a Roger Sadowski Telecaster style instrument, which is on a lot of those recordings, which is a wonderful instrument. And then I switched more recently to a guitar made by a company called Brian Moore. It's called Brian Moore Custom Guitars. It's not custom made for me, but it's like a Les Paul with a switch, just as, you know, for the guitar guys, a five-way switch so you can move it and split the pickups and make it sound like single coil pickups if you want. It's got a beefy, fat sound. It's got a nice bridge pickup, and it also has, under the bridge, it has a piezo pickup, which is sort of a fake acoustic pickup for those that don't know. It's like a little crystals. Actually, I don't know how this one works, but they're under each string, and, you know, if you listen with your eyes closed from a distance of, you know, like several thousand yards, it almost sounds like it's an acoustic instrument.
Okay.
So I use that kind of blended in with the magnetic pickups. And with the regular guitar pickups, and I find it creates an interesting sound. It still sounds like the guitar, but gives it a little bit of a shine that doesn't have normally. And I also bought a handmade guitar by a wonderful maker in California named Jim Mapson, which is like a little, very thin-bodied arch top with one, just a pickup in the neck. And I'll probably play that on a couple of tunes, because it's, you know, it is a pretty open guitar, so in a certain situation it may feed back a little, but it's... Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful instrument. So those are the two I'm playing mostly right now. I have a room full of guitars.
Yeah.
But
most guitar players.
We tend to collect. I don't know how it happens. It's just, I have an old Les Paul. You know, I've got my Ibanez. I've got a wonderful old 175 from the ES-175 from the 50s, which I never bring on the road. But it's probably the best guitar I have. I have two handmade guitars by a maker named Rick McCurdy in New York that are wonderful. A big arch top and then a small body guitar, also lovely. You know, and I have played them. They've all been on the road. They've all been on a record date. I mean, they've all had some use, but you can't mm-hmm. use them all the time.
Right.
Which is a shame. I wish I could just have about 10 hands. I could just like maybe go around and play them all at once every day just to keep everybody happy. Okay. Sometimes I think I should do that. Just open up the case and say, okay, now I'm going to play you for 5 minutes. And then,
yeah.
At least we communicated today. You know?
Good karma.
Good karma for the. Yeah, well, I think it's important. If an instrument sits too long, it can die.
Hmm.
I had a beautiful old guitar kind of die on me years ago, an acoustic instrument, and it'll happen.
Anybody, just to wrap up, that you haven't played with, that you wish you could.
Well, I always said. I mean, it's probably because of my connection to Jim Hall and what he did with Sonny Rollins. Is I always like to. I've gotten a chance to play with Jim. Well, I'd like to play with him a little more. I mean, maybe just one-on-one. That would be great. We've done some on concerts, but it's never been a real, just sitting down in a room and playing, you know. Mm-hmm. That would be very cool. I'd like to do that. But I'd love to play with Sonny Rollins. And one drummer that I play with a lot of the great drummers, you know, Dejanet, and I played with Roy Haynes a few times, and I played with, you know, Billy Hart, and just, you know, Peter Erskine, Adam Nussbaum, just a whole slew of great drummers, but I haven't played with Elvin Jones. And I just think that's got to be great. I mean, how can that not be great? I mean, it's impossible. That would be impossible not to feel great playing mm-hmm. with him, right? I mean, that's just, come on, he's sort of like the epitome somehow of a certain kind of drumming and a certain kind of feel that I think I would just fall in play with very easily, which is why I like to play with Nussbaum a lot, because Nussbaum is kind of like, comes from that basis, you know, it's a very wide open, just natural feel that just feels like, yeah, this is the way this music is meant to be played. You know?
Uh-huh.
So those two, I would say, or three, including Jim, I guess, you know, of the sort of people you would know, you know, that's who I'd want to play with. Yeah.
Okay. I wish you best in your future projects and
thanks.
Juggling all the things, you know, when I look at your resumes and so forth that mm-hmm. people send out, it's quite amazing. How much recording you've done, and how many people you've played with, and people that have played with you.
Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, I one day I sat down. I was traveling with Peter Erskine on a bus. This is a good 7-8 years ago. And just, he said, we were both very bored and we're tired. And he said, why don't you write down? He said, everything you've ever recorded on. And he said, and you can leave nothing out. I mean, even the worst possible like thing that you don't want anyone to know about, you have to include it. And we just kind of wrote down as many things as we could think. And I think at that time I was up to about like 80 or nine, wow. And he was up to like already recording, and he's younger than me, and he's about 150 projects. You imagine what a guy like, you know, Ron Carter and these people are probably like on like, you know, a couple of thousand albums, you know.
Can you remember the worst thing you ever did? Would you like to?
You know, I don't know if I can remember. I do remember one, and I could. Yeah, I do remember what I considered probably to be one of the actually worst projects I ever did. Maybe the worst. And there were some great people on it, but it was, and I won't tell you the name of the person whose record it was, because I've never heard from him since. I think this was his one chance at trying to make a record. I don't know if he was a tax write-off, or if just somebody really liked him and just wanted to give him a chance. But he was a piano player, and it was just really, he really couldn't, he just couldn't play. I mean, but he had gotten this band together. He actually, on the record was myself, Jack DeJohnette, Stanley Clark, Freddie Hubbard, and a lot of people, and more, you know, I mean. And that might have to go down. I can't remember the. I do remember the name of the record. I remember the guy's name, and it wouldn't be worth saying it, but okay. it was pretty bad. And I think I've actually had a couple of people I've spoken to and said, "Oh yeah, I heard that record. Man, what a terrible, that was a rotten record that is. Why'd you do that?" I only had one answer. I did it for money. Mm-hmm. Somebody offered me extremely good money to fly me out and do this project, and I figured, well, gee, all these great musicians, it's got to be good. And it wasn't. And in a situation like that, it wasn't just that he didn't sound good. Nobody really sounded good. Everything just kind of came down to this bass level. It just, I mean, I sounded terrible. I mean, you know, and it's hard to know when you're going to say, you know, how things are going to sound when you record or even when you play a gig. But if you're going into a situation with people you don't really know anything about, it could get weird. I'm doing a recording actually on Sunday in Montreal with some Canadian musicians, and Dave Liebman's playing on it. And I do know one of the musicians I know is playing. The other one I don't know that well. The drummer I don't know at all. But I know Dave, and I know, I got a sense this is going to be probably pretty good, a good one. I mean, it'll be good. I just hope that I play good on it, you know. Because when you're recording, you've got the whole recording stigma, you know, can I hear myself properly? You know, the recording is not a natural, it's not like playing in a club or a concert hall. Yeah. Sometimes you can't hear what you're doing as well, or you can't hear the piano or the horn player or the drummer. You're just not hearing properly. And a lot of times the recordings are made, and people will say to me, gee, that was kind of a strange recording. And so I'll say, look, I couldn't hear anything I played on that record. I remember doing one record where literally, I think I played like by Braille. I mean, I just couldn't hear the rhythm section. My sound sounded like it was coming from underneath blankets, and the drummer sounded really far away, and that was just the best it could get in the headphones. Mm-hmm. And it was a small studio, and I just was dreadful. It doesn't sound so bad on the record, but I remember, you know, recording is a strange one.
Yeah.
It can be really satisfying, and can also be very, very devastating if it's not good, because then you hear the playback, and it's like looking into a mirror, you know, and it's like seeing all the stuff you don't like, you know, oh God, there's a wrinkle, you know, or why is that there? You know, you see all the good stuff, but you also see a lot of the bad stuff about your playing.
Right. So. Well, I hope those are few and far between for you.
They're getting fewer and farther between as I get older, yeah.
All right. Well, thanks for your time today.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Look forward to hearing you tonight.
Okay, nice to meet you.